Sounder, Chapter 7. When the boy came home after each long trip in search of his father, the crippled coonhound would wobble or hobble far down the road to meet him, wag his tail, stand on his hind legs, and paw the boy with his good front paw. But never a sound beyond a deep whine came from him. The bit of news he might bring home his mother received in silence. Someone had heard that his father was moved. Someone had been in the same work gang with his father for 4 months last summer on the Walker County Road. When she had heard all that he had heard, she would say, "There's patience, child, and waitin' that's got to be." Word drifted back that there had been a terrible dynamite blast in one of the quarries that had killed 12 convicts and wounded several others. His mother had the people read her the story from their newspapers when she carried the laundry. None of the prisoners killed was the boy's father. The months and seasons of searching dragged into years. The boy helped his mother carry more and more baskets of laundry to and from the big houses. The clotheslines grew longer and longer. The other children, except for the littlest, could fetch and tote too, but they didn't like to go by themselves. "Time is passing," the woman would say. "I wish you wouldn't go looking, child." But when one of the field hands had heard something, or when somebody said that a road camp was moving, she would wrap a piece of bread and meat for the boy to eat on the way and say nothing. Looking back from far down the road, the boy would see her watching at the edge of the porch. She seemed to understand the compulsion that started him on each long, fruitless journey with new hope. Once, the boy waited outside a tall wire fence of a road camp. Some convicts were whitewashing stones along the edge of a pathway that came towards the gate near where he stood. One might be his father, he thought. He could not tell until they got closer, for they crawled on their hands and knees as they bent over the stones. He leaned against the fence and hooked his fingers through the wire. If none of them was his father, they might know something anyway, he thought. He wished they would stand up and walk from one stone to the next. Then he would know his father easily by his walk. He could still remember the sound of his footsteps approaching the cabin after dark, the easy roll of the never-hurrying step that was the same when he went to work in the morning and when he came home from the long day in the fields. The boy had even been able to tell his father's walk by the swing of the lantern at his side, but none of the men whitewashing round the rocks that lined the path stood up and walked. They crawled the few feet from stone to stone, and crawling, they all looked the same. Suddenly, something crashed against the fence in front of the boy's face. A jagged piece of iron tore open the skin and crushed the fingers of one of his hands against the fence. Lost in thought and watching the convicts, the boy had not seen the guard, who had been sitting under a tree with a shotgun across his knees, get up and come to a toolbox filled with picks and crowbars which stood nearby. The piece of iron lay on the inside of the fence at the boy's feet. Drops of blood from his fingers dripped down the fence from wire to wire and fell on the ground. The boy pulled his fingers away from the wire mesh and began to suck on them to stop the throbbing. Tears ran down over his face and mixed with the blood on his hand. Little rivulets of blood and water ran down his arm and dropped off the end of his elbow. The guard was swaying back and forth with laughter. His gun lay on the lid of the open toolbox. His arms swung in an ape-like gyrations of glee, and he held another piece of iron in one hand and his cap in the other. A white strip of forehead where his uniform cap kept off the sun shone between his brown hair and his sunburned face. His laughter had burst the button from his tieless shirt collar, and a white strip outlined his gaunt neck. For a second, he reminded the boy of a garden scarecrow blowing in the wind, body and head of a brown burlap stuffed with straw, the head tied on with a white rag, just like the white band around the guard's neck, the head tilting from side to side, inviting a well-placed stone to send it bouncing along a bean row. The men whitewashing the rocks made no sounds. No one among them suddenly raised himself to the height of a man almost as tall as a cabin porch post. "He ain't there," the boy murmured to himself. If he was, the boy knew by now he would be holding the scarecrow of a man in the air with one hand clamped all the way around the white strip on the skinny neck, the way he had seen Sounder clamp his great jaws on a weasel once, with his head stuck out one side of the jaws and the body the other. And the man would wheeze and squirm like the weasel had. His legs would paw the air in circles like his hands. Then he would go limp, and the boy's father would loosen his grip, and the man in the brown uniform would fall in a heap, like when somebody untied the white rag that held the scarecrow to the stake. And the heap would roll down the slope and lodge against the fence, like the scarecrow rolled along a bean row until it caught in the brambles at the edge of the garden. Feeling defeat in the midst of his glee because the boy had not run but stood still and defiant, sucking the blood from his bruised finger, the guard stopped laughing and yelled at him, "That'll show you, boy! Get! And get fast!" The boy turned and, without looking back, began to walk slowly away. The guard began to laugh again and threw the scrap of iron over the fence. It landed a few feet from the boy. He looked at the iron, and he looked at the man. The white spot between his hair and his eyes was the spot. The iron would split it open with a wide gash, and blood would darken the white spot and make it into the color of the man's sunburned face. And the stone that David slung struck Goliath on his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell on his face on the ground, the boy thought. But he left the iron on the ground. Still sucking his fingers, the boy looked once more at the men whitewashing the stones. They were almost at the gate. He didn't need to wait and ask. His father was not crawling among them. Later that day, passing along a street in a strange and lonely town, he saw a man dump a box of trash into a barrel. He noticed that a large brown black book went in the trash. He waited until the man went back into the building, and then he took the book from the barrel. It was a book of stories about what people think. There were titles such as Cruelty, Excellent Men, Education, Cripples, Justice, and many others. The boy sat down, leaned back against the barrel, and began to read from the story called Cruelty. I have often heard it said that cowardice is the mother of cruelty, and I have found by experience that malicious and inhuman animosity and fierceness are usually accompanied by weakness. Wolves and filthy bears and all the baser beasts fall upon the dying. The boy was trying to read aloud, for he could understand it better if he heard the words, but now he stopped. He did not understand what it said. The words were too new and strange. He was sad. He thought books would have words like the ones he had learned to read in the store signs, words like his mother used when she told him stories of the Lord and Joseph and David. All his life, he had wanted a book. Now he held one in his hands, and it was only making his bruised fingers hurt more. He would carry it with him anyway. He passed a large brick schoolhouse with big windows and children climbing on little ladders and swinging on swings. No one jeered at him or noticed him because he had crossed the street and was walking close up against the hedge on the other side. Soon the painted houses ran out, and he was walking past unpainted cabins. He always felt better on his travels when he came to the part of town where the unpainted cabins were. Sometimes people came out on the porch when he passed and talked to him. Sometimes they gave him a piece to eat on the way. Now he thought they might laugh and say, "What you carrying, child? A book?" So he held it up close against him. "That's a school, too," the boy said to himself as he stood facing a small, unpainted building with a door at the end of the side, the way cabin doors were. Besides, he could always tell a school because it had more windows than a cabin. At the side of the building, two children were sloshing water out of a tin pail near a hand pump. One threw a dipper of water on a dog that came from underneath to bark at the boy. The school was built on posts, and a stovepipe came through the wall and stuck up above the rafters. A rusty tin pipe from the corner of the roof down to the cistern where the children were playing. The dog had gone back under the building, so the boy entered the yard and moved towards the children. If one of them would work the pump handle, he could wash the dried blood off his hand. Just when he reached the cistern, a wild commotion of barking burst from under the floor of the school. Half a dozen dogs, which followed children to school and waited patiently for lunchtime scraps and for school to be over, burst from under the building in pursuit of a pig that had wandered onto the lot. In the wild chase around the building was the biggest dog struck. The biggest dog struck the tin drain pipe, and it clattered down the wall and bounced on the cement top of the cistern. With a pig under the building and the dogs barking and racing in and out, the school day ended. 2 dozen or more children raced out the door, few of them touching the 3 steps that led from the stoop to the ground. Some were calling names of dogs and looking under the building. The boy found himself surrounded by strange, inquiring eyes. Questions came too fast. You new here? Where you moved to? That your book? You coming here to school? Can you read that a big book? The boy had put his bruised hand into his pocket so no one could see it. Some of the children carried books too, but none were as big as the one he held close against his side. Just when the commotion was quieting down, a man appeared at the school door. The children scattered across the lot in 4 directions. "Tell your pa he must keep his pig in the pen," he called to one child. Then it was quiet. The boy looked at the man in the doorway. They were alone now. The dogs had followed the children, and the pig, hearing a familiar call from the corner of the lot, had come grunting from his sanctuary, gone in the direction of the call. In his many journeyings among strangers, the boy had learned to sniff out danger and spot orneriness quickly. Now, for the first time in his life away from home, he wasn't feared. The lean, elderly man with snow-white hair, wearing Sunday clothes, came down the steps. "This pipe has always fallen," he said as he picked it up and put it back in place. "I need to wire it up. I just wanted to wash my hands. It's got dried blood on it where I hurt my fingers. You should have run home. I don't live in these parts. Here, I'll hold your book and I'll pump for you." And the mellow eyes of the man began to search the boy for answers. Answers that could be found without asking questions. "We need warm soapy water," the teacher said. "I live right close. Wait till I get my papers and lock the door. I'll take you home and fix it." The boy wanted to follow the man into the schoolhouse and see what it was like inside. But by the time he got to the steps, the man was back again, locking the door. "I usually put the school in order after the children leave," he said, "but I'll do it in the morning before they get here." At the end of the school lot, the man took the road that led away from the town. They walked without much talk, and the boy began to wish the man would ask him a lot of questions. When they had passed several cabins, each farther from another as they went, the man turned off the road and said, "We're home. I live here alone, have lived alone for a long time." Fingering the small wire hook on the neatly whitewashed gate, which led into a yard that was green, the teacher stopped talking. "A cabin with a gate and green grass in a yard is almost a big house," the boy thought as he followed the man. Inside the gate, the man went along the fence, studying some plants tied up to stakes. He began to talk again, not to the boy, but to a plant that was smaller than the others. "You'll make it, little one, but it'll take time to get your roots set again." The boy looked at the white-haired old man leaning over like he was listening for the plant to answer him. "He's conjured," the boy whispered to himself. "Lots of folks is conjured or addled." He moved backwards to the gate, thinking he'd better run away. "Conjured folks can conjure you," the boy's mother had always said, "if you get yourself plain carried off by their soft spell talk." But before the boy could trouble his mind any more, the man straightened up and began talking to him. Some animal dug under the roots and tore them loose from the earth. It was wilted badly and might have died, but I reset it and I water it every day. It's hard to reset a plant if it's wilted too much. The life has gone out of it. But this one will be all right. I see new leaves starting. What grows on it? The boy asked, thinking it must be something good to eat if somebody cared that much about a plant. It's only a flower, the man said. I'll water it when the earth has cooled a little. If you water a plant when the earth is too warm, it shocks the roots. Inside the cabin, the man started a fire in the cook stove and heated water. As he washed the boy's hand with a soft white rag, he said, "You must have slammed these fingers in an awfully heavy door gate." Before the boy could answer, the teacher began to talk about the plant he must remember to water. "He don't want to know nothing about me," the boy thought. "When I saw your book, I thought you were coming to enroll for school, but you don't live in these parts, you say." I found the book in a trash barrel. It has words I ain't used to reading. I can read store signs, words, and some newspaper for words." "This is a wonderful book," said the teacher. "It was written by a man named Montagny, who was a soldier, but he grew tired of being a soldier and spent his time studying and writing. He also liked to walk on country roads." The teacher lit two lamps. The boy had never seen two lamps burning in the same room. They made the room as bright as daylight. "People should read his writings," the man continued, "but few do. He is all but forgotten." But the boy did not hear. He was thinking of a cabin that had two lamps, both lit at the same time, and two stoves, one to cook on and one to warm by. The man sat in a chair between two tables that held the lamps. There were books on the tables, too. There were shelves filled not with pans and dishes, but with books. The mellow eyes of the man followed the boy's puzzled glances, suddenly found himself. "I will read you a little story from your book." The boy watched as the fingers of the man turned the pages one way and then the other until he found what he wanted to read. "This is a very short story about a king named Cyrus who wanted to buy the prize horse that belonged to one of his soldiers. Cyrus asked him how much he would sell the horse for, or whether he would exchange him for a kingdom. The soldier said he would not sell his prize horse, and he would not exchange him for a kingdom, but that he would willingly give up the horse to gain a new friend. But now I have told you the whole story, so there's no use for me to read it." "You've been a powerful good friend to take me in like this," the boy said at last. "My fingers don't hurt no more. I am your friend," said the man. "So while I heat some water to soak your hand and make you your cot for the night, you tell me about yourself." "I had a father and a dog named Sounder," the boy began.